Welcome to the first tutorial in the lecture Reinforcement Learning. My name is Wilhelm Kirchgessner. I'm one of three tutors who are going to guide you through the tutorials and exercises in this semester. In each tutorial, we will work with Python notebooks. These are web-based platforms where we can run Python code and Markdown. So the first thing we will look at is how to set up a UPython notebook, how we can run that on our own machines, and how we get the necessary dependencies in our Python environment. If you have a look at the material we have provided you with for this first tutorial, you will find a README Markdown file or PDF, which you can open, and the content is the same. You will see first introductory steps on how to get a UPython notebook running on your own machine. So if you follow this first link here for installing Anaconda, you will get prompted to the Anaconda website, which you can follow. And having followed these steps, you should have your Anaconda set up. So what is Anaconda? Anaconda is a software tool with which we can install different Python packages in different separate environments, Python environments, which is very helpful if you have a lot of projects. But in terms of this tutorial and for all other tutorials, it might be sufficient to have just one Python environment or the system environment. So don't get confused with this one, maybe in the beginning. If you're a complete beginner, don't worry about environments. Just go with the default one. So having installed Anaconda, you should be able to start a UPython notebook. How does that look like? Here in the README file, we say just type in UPython notebook in your terminal. If you are using Windows, the correct terminal would be the so-called conda prompt, which you can start from your start menu. If you have your terminal open, you can just go into the folder first, where the exercise is saved, where you have saved the material for this exercise. Then just type in UPython notebook, enter, and you see there's one tab opening, and this is the Explorer view on the files which are part of the first tutorial. So you see we have eight sub-tutorials in this very first one. Some of them we will go through very briefly in order to understand what the Python language is and how to work with that, what are the most important packages for Python. But some of those notebooks are also means for your own exercise, so we won't go through them in this video. If you want to open a notebook, we just click on them. Let's start with the very first lesson here, introduction. We click on it and there is another tab going to open, which shows the content of the corresponding UPython notebook. So now we see what's the gestalt of the notebook. We have several cells here. So this cell is the first cell, this cell is the second cell, this one is the third one, and this is not another cell, but the output of this third cell. What does that mean? We will see later. First of all, maybe in order to get the hang of UPython notebooks, we have a menu ribbon here on top where we can choose, for example, under kernel, whether we want to stop or continue the server, the Python server running all the cells here. Under cell, we can define whether a cell should be run or whether we want to run a lot of cells. And very important here now, the cell type, which is maybe the first thing we should have a look at, because as I said earlier, we in a UPython notebook we can run Python cells but also Markdown. Where's the difference? Markdown is just a descriptive language for rendering text and highlighting different passages, and Python of course is a programming language, so there's a different compiler going through, a different interpreter. So here, for example, we see two markdown cells. This one is a markdown cell. This is the markdown cell. And here the third cell, this is a Python cell with Python code, which we can run. If you want to edit a cell, you just double click on it. And then you see we enter the edit mode of that cell. Here we see now the syntax of markdown, a hashtag for a first level header, a double hashtag for a second level header, three hashtags for a third level header, and so on. Hyperlinks, you have this syntax here, and same for the second cell here, which is also markdown. I double click on it and you can see the table is now formatted in the markdown style. If we are happy with the way the content looks like now, we just execute cells, which we can do by clicking on cell and then run cell, or we use some shortcuts, in this case Control Enter or Shift Enter, and then you see the cell is rendered again. The same handling is done with Python cells. Here we have some Python code. If I click on it, I can directly edit it. There is no rendering mode or editing mode, it's always the same. And I can run this cell with Shift Enter or Control Enter. When a cell is running, you see there's a star. This means that your server is currently busy running that cell. So here you see for me the picture is now white. For you it will be also white. I have a dark skin here on my UPython notebooks. That's why I prefer to use also dark backgrounds in my plots. So for this we have this line which I just commented in again. If I run it again, you see it will be, I can see actually the white ticks, labels, y-axis, x-axis. If we want more cells, we can just add them by going top to the menu ribbon and click on insert. Insert cell below or cell above, depends on where our cursor is currently at. We are at the third cell here, so if I say insert cell below, you see there is a cell inserted below. If I want to have a cell above of that, I click on insert cell above. And so we can add arbitrarily many cells and execute as many cells as we want. You can also delete them again. If you click on a cell and say edit and delete cells, then it will delete our cells like this. Okay, so now dealing with the content of our first lecture. So we have seen how to set up a UPython server, UPython notebook server, how to run a notebook. And now we can start with talking about the Python language, which is the core topic of this first tutorial. Maybe first of all, before we start with the first lessons, I would like to give credit to the departments, to the communications department and the measurement engineering department, who were building up the first version of this exercise in a group project. And this first tutorial is also inspired on this material which they have provided. So if it happens that you have attended this Python crash course already, which was run by the communications engineering department and the measurement engineering department, then you have seen most of the content which we are going through in this tutorial already, just for you to know. So then you could skip this first tutorial. So a few years ago, in all hands-on engineering tutorials, there was the MATLAB language more popular. But nowadays you would actually encounter the Python language rather than MATLAB because of various reasons. So we have enlisted a lot of advantages and disadvantages between those two languages. If you are familiar with MATLAB, then you would better understand the differences here. If you're new to both languages, then you don't need to mind very much about this. The most distinctive difference between those two languages is maybe that Python is open source, so you can work with it everywhere on each machine without worrying about licenses or how to get a MATLAB license, how to connect to the VPN of the university, for example, in order to get access to a license. All this is history now if we switch over to Python, because this one's open source. And because it is open source, you also have directly access to bleeding edge development, to state-of-the-art packages, which are developed every day by the broad research field, or by any research field. That's why Python is also getting more and more popular in different areas of research, in different study domains. So it is reasonable for this course to also work with Python. And if you're not familiar with Python, then it's a good time to get started with that language. So Python has some built-in functionality, some built-in commands and classes and functions you can work with. But this is not going to help us deal with any problem we are going to encounter. There are numerous packages on top of the standard Python, which we are going to import, which will help us for different applications. For example, if we want to do numerical computation, so that means every time we work with matrices or vectors and want to do dot products or any form of linear algebra, then we would do that actually with the NumPy package, which is part of the Anaconda distribution. So all of those, most of those packages you see here are already part of the Anaconda distribution, so you don't need to worry about installing it first. It will be there already. So NumPy is something we will face a lot in all the tutorials in this lecture. Matplotlib, the second package here, is for everything related to visualizations. We can do plots with this package, and everything below that is going to be secondary for this lecture. So we will, most of the time, we will deal with NumPy and Matplotlib. But if you are interested in other applications, then you can also, or we recommend to have a look in those packages here. For example, Pandas, which is the package for table operations. What is a table in this manner? It is like a two-dimensional tensor, a two-dimensional matrix, which has labels, columns and labeled rows. So everything which is stored in databases, for example, or if you have a data set where columns are any type of feature or sensors, and the rows would correspond to separate observations, then this is also nicely formatted into a table, into a Pandas table. But if you don't care much about labels or label columns, then you could also, of course, do it with NumPy. There's also scikit-learn, which is a toolbox for classic machine learning applications. We are not going to use that here in this tutorial, as far as I can foresee that, or in any other tutorial. But if you want to get in touch with, if you want to make first experience with machine learning, then this is probably the package to have a look at, because they have a good repertoire of machine learning models. For neural networks, there are currently two packages very popular. One is TensorFlow 2 actually, and PyTorch. They both have a different syntax, but throughout the years they are getting more similar and similar. So there's no single recommendation I would give you over which package you should prefer. Both are similar good. SymPy for symbolic computations, and Seaborn for even nicer plots, but this is just for eye candies. Okay, what does Python actually look like. So here we have a very short cell or a few lines of code where we showcase what Python usually looks like. So on top of a cell, or maybe in the very first cell, you would very likely see some imports. Here we have the NumPy package imported and the matplotlib package imported. And with this S syntax, we just abbreviate NumPy package with NP and the matplotlib or the sub package called pyplot with PLT. So we don't need to use the full name of those packages throughout our code here. You see here's PLT again and here's NumPy occurring. So after importing some packages, which is actually pretty similar to other programming languages as well, we can start declaring some variables. Here we are declaring some variables, and here as well, declaring some variables, doing some computations on those variables, and after that we plot them with matplotlib functions. Now a distinctive feature of Python, which is not often the case in any programming language, is that we do not need to declare any data types in beforehand for our variables. You see, I just came up with some names and I just assigned them a number here. It could be anything. And this is completely okay in Python. You don't need to declare that in beforehand. But in turn, that also means that you have to take care a little bit more how you handle each variable, and take care that you do not confuse some integer with some string, for example, because that might not be directly inferable from reading the code. All right, so this is what Python looks like. The certain implementations here, the certain functions we're calling here, we are going through them in the next lessons. Now let's go on to the next lesson. I'm closing that tab and we are going to open lesson number 2, JupyTar. If we open it up, it's a very short notebook. You see here some examples of markdown formatted text. So here we have a one hashtag again for a level 1 header. In this one, a second level header, some hyperlinks, and an enumeration, also quite handy, and a table, same as we have seen before in the overview notebook. You can play around in this notebook and get the hang of editing notebooks. Try to append some cells below, above, try to write some markdown text. Very important again, if you create a new cell, for example, or a few cells, then by default these are going to be Python code. You see, I'm writing something and the Python interpreter tries to make some sense out of it. But if you want to write markdown text, then you have to convert these cells in beforehand. You do that here above at cell type, and then convert to markdown. And now this is going to be a markdown cell at level 2. Some text rendering. There you go. If you have played around a little bit with this notebook, then we can go over to the third lesson, which would be the Python overview. Now we will have a more detailed look at the Python syntax, which is the core topic of this tutorial. First of all, a few more shortcuts for editing JupyTar notebooks. Here are the most important ones. I personally use a lot A, B, M, and Y for converting cells to markdown and back to code, or for editing cells above and below. But there are, of course, more shortcuts which you can look up under help and then keyboard shortcuts. Okay, so most basic Python is here in this cell. You can see we have some name. You can come up with any name you like for any variable. It should start with a letter though. You can't start with a alphanumerical. And you can assign it any letter, any value you want. It can be an integer. It can also be a floating point number. And it can also be, of course, a string, which I call string name. Hello. I execute that and you see I have now three variables with three different values, three different data types. Maybe one word for how to output something in a cell. You see I executed the cell and there's no output under the cell. This is because this assignment operation is not outputting anything. If I want to output any value under a cell, I need to make sure that the last line is outputting anything. For example, if I just write the variable name here and execute that, we get the string representation of that variable outputted under the cell here. If I now want the other variables to be output below, you might think that you just write the other names below here, string name, float name, and integer name. But you see, it is only the last line which is outputted. If you want more prints or more outputs, then we would use the print function, which is also a built-in function of Python. So if I write print in beforehand, then you will see that we will have all three variables printed out. And I think in any programming language there is some similar function to print. So Python's print is called print. Now we don't have only integers, floating point variables, and strings. We also have complex numbers. You can have complex numbers if you append a J next to a letter. Then it will be a complex number. For string variables, there are several ways to declare a string variable. You can do it with an apostrophe in the beginning and in the end, or with a quotation mark. It's up to you how you do this. Maybe important, if you actually want an apostrophe within a string or a quotation mark, make sure that the other string definition is encapsulating that string. So here, that apostrophe is not declaring the beginning of a new string, but is part of the string actually, for example. The same way I can add a quotation mark here without the Python interpreter thinking that there's a new string beginning there. Alright, and there's also another way to declare strings by having three times the apostrophe or the quotation mark. What's the difference between those two? We would use three times the quotation mark if we want to have a multi-line string. So that means I can press enter here and add more text. If I enter this, you can see we have the output of string 4 here from the print function, which is a multi-line string. You can't do this with only a single apostrophe or a single quotation mark. That's why we sometimes need three quotation marks. And sometimes, of course, you don't want to just print a variable, but a bit more text around it. So that's where we use F-formatted strings. F-formatted means that we put an F letter in before the string. This is the string, and here we have an F. And having an F before the string means that the interpreter is looking out for curly braces, as it is here. And within the curly braces, you can put variables which are going to be printed then accordingly, according to their string representation. So integer name, we have saved a 1 in the cell above. So accordingly, the print function will print integer value colon 1. Okay, if we go over to arithmetic operations, then we have the usual plus minus. We also have the usual multiplication, the usual division. And if you want to calculate some number to the power of something, then you can use different ways of typing that. For example, the double asterisk or double multiplication sign is used to notify the interpreter that this is actually 2 to the power of 2, not 2 times 2. So if we execute this cell, you see there's a 4 for the last line. We can say 2 to the power of 3, it's 8 accordingly, 4 for 16, and so on. If we want to type large numbers, we can type them just as they are, or we can optionally also put underscores in between them just to have it more readable. There is no actual functionality in those underscores between numbers. So I could also put some more underscores here, and you see it will be interpreted correctly into that large number. I could, of course, can just omit those underscores. They're not really necessary. They are just omitted later. You can see I can also put just 2 numbers here. It's going to be omitted. Also, we have the E symbol, which stands for 2 to the power of. So 2 times 10 to the power of 4 is then accordingly 200,000. Very important, if you use E, then you will end up in a floating point number. If you use the double asterisk, then you usually come up with a integer. If both numbers here are integers, of course, as well. Like this. Alright, so this is how we do exponentials. Then we have divisions. There are 2 types of divisions. If you just use 1 slash, then we have a floating point division, even though we have 2 integers here. But if the result of this division is a fractal, then with a 1 slash division we get the correct answer. If you really need integer values by rounding, then use double slash, then you see it will be rounded to 20 here. So this is the arithmetic operation. Now we have collections, which is very powerful in Python or in any other language. Collections are like arrays, but you can store anything you like there, not only numbers, but also strings, any data type you like. This is the case for lists, but there's even more next to lists. You will see them later. So a list, you can imagine, is like an array, but it can store any data type, so it has mixed elements. It can have mixed elements. The way we declare a list is with those braces here. So everything within here is going to be a comma-separated list within L. If I execute that, you can see integer name is now the first element in that string. The order is maintained. So this is an ordered list. 1, 2, 3 is a string here. So we have an integer and a string right after that integer in this list. We can even put lists into lists and recurse into that as far as we would like. There's almost no limitation. So this is a list with 4 integer elements, which is the third element in the L list here. And the fourth element is then some complex number. If you want to add more elements to the list, we would do that with append. Append 5, and you see here below we have another element. If you want to add more elements to a list, for example another list, which should extend the first list, then we would do that with extend. So here, for example, we have a list called M with 2 elements, and we want L to contain those 2 elements as well, then we would go with L extend. As you can see, it worked out, but there's also another way of doing this, just with the plus sign. So since we have L in the last line, we get only the L outputted. We have to erase that. And now you see the output of L plus M is 30, is the original list plus the M list. This is maybe a nice way to showcase something different. If I just say L plus M and now print L, you'll see that it will show me only the original list, it's not the appended one. That's because I have not defined L to be the extension. Just after having this assignment here, this L plus M is saved into L, and then I will actually see the extended list. How do we index lists? It's very likely to MATLAB and indexing arrays. But as for any good programming languages, is the rule we start indices as of zero. So the first element in a list is going to be L, and then these braces here of zero. If you want the last element in a list, we index them with minus one. If we want the penultimate element, then we would say minus two. If we want a range of elements within a list, then we would separate the first index of the first element and the last index of the last element with a colon. So indexing from 0 to minus 1 would return us the full list except for the last one, because this style of indexing is inclusive of the starting index but exclusive of the ending index. So that means if you print that, you actually see for the third line that we are missing the 40 here, because we wanted everything up to minus one, the last element, but exclusive the last element. Same thing as if I would write here 3, for example, that would return the element on index 0, 1, and 2, but not on 3. As you can see, 0, 1, and 2. We can add another column, which would then define in which steps we want to go from the beginning up to the last element. If you write 2, then we would just get every element from the very first index up to, but not inclusive, the last element in steps of 2. So that means we are going to get the first element, then the third element, and then the fifth element. If you would like to do those steps throughout the full list, then you don't need to specify 0 and minus 1, since that would also not include the last element, right? You would actually just write 2 columns and the step size, and then it will take the full list, and then iterate through it in step sizes of 2. Maybe that is going to be more flexible if I add another one here, another element. Oh, and now you see there is another element here for the other syntax. All right, tuples. What are tuples? Tuples are almost the same as lists, but you can imagine them to be lists that are read-only. So you can't change a tuple after it has been declared, it's only to be read. So what can we do with tuples? We can of course read them and assign them to new variables, but we can also come up with new tuples which consists of different tuples. So we have a tuple t and a tuple t2. If we say t plus t2, we will get the extension of both. This is okay. We have not modified neither t nor t2, but actually made a new variable, which is the summation of both. We haven't stored them. We haven't stored this new variable anywhere. It is just printed. The same goes for here. We do not modify t. Instead, we are creating a new variable, a new temporary variable, t times 3, which actually means not to multiply each element by 3, but to repeat the tuple three times. The same goes for lists, by the way. Be careful not to mix that up. Since lists and tuples are not arrays, there is not the usual syntax you have in MATLAB, for example, where you would make a scalar times array operation, maybe with an asterisk as it is here. This is something completely different if you work with lists and tuples, as you can see here. Okay, and the other very, very handy collection in Python is a so-called dictionary, or short dict. A dictionary is a unordered collection of key and value pairs. So here we have a dictionary. We start defining a dictionary with curly braces. Yeah, so a list was with this sort of braces. The tuple was a parenthesis. And the dictionary is with curly braces, starting with curly braces. And you have to define a dictionary always in terms of elements, which consists of a key and a value, which are separated by a colon. Dictionaries are similarly flexible as lists in so far that you can have anything as key and anything as value. So here in this element, the key is a string A. The value which is mapping from that key is an integer 1. The second element, it's vice versa. We have an integer as a key and a string B as value. And for the third element, it's the same as for the first element. Recursion is also possible here. So a key could be again a dictionary or a list, and a value could also be again a dictionary or a list of dictionaries. There is no limitation. Indexing in a dictionary, it actually depends on the Python version. Before 3.6, dictionaries were actually unordered, but now they are actually ordered. So if I define that dictionary by running that cell, then I can actually access also the elements of that dictionary. So if I access 2, 2 is 1, it's a key. So he will find something there, and he will return the value directly, B. And this is actually also ordered with a newer Python version, such that if you would iterate through this, you would always get the same order over and over again. You can get all the keys at once with the dictionary.keys. You see here it will return A, 2, and C. For values, you will get all the values. And if you say items, then you will get a so-called iterator, which you can loop through. You will maybe see later how you can use this for iterations. But the important fact for now is now that you would get the key value pairs one after the other if you call items in a dictionary. An empty dictionary would be then just curly braces like here. You can do the same for a list, to have an empty list like this. Empty list is now square bracket, and correspondingly an empty tuple is created with a parenthesis. Now we have the first exercises here for you. We have learned some concepts about very important collections in Python, and with these exercises you can work on these new concepts. You would need to know how to instantiate these new collections. Maybe to save you from some pitfalls, let me tell you that a list of one element list can be instantiated with square brackets in around your element, for example a one integer, and a one element tuple. Now this is tricky. It's going to be an element and then a comma after that element. Why is that so? If we would omit that comma, then the Python interpreter would understand these parentheses as something it can omit, the same way as you can omit something like 1 plus 2 and you would make parentheses around the 2. Python would think then that you can omit these parentheses. Same with those outer parentheses. So in order to declare actually a tuple and not some priority in mathematical operations, you would need to add a comma here in the tuple, which is not the case for the lists. All right. This one, and you would also need to know for the last exercise here, how to loop through items of a dictionary. So that's why I'm going to show you that really quick as well. So if we take our dictionary on top here, it is called dictionary. I will execute this cell here again. You see with these numbers the order in which those cells were run. So now I run this cell again. I instantiate this dictionary with these three elements again. So if I execute this cell again, now I have my dictionary again. And if I want to loop through these elements, I would do this with the following syntax. I would say for key value, where key and value is arbitrary. I could also say k and v, whatever, in dictionary.items colon. And now, very important, if you have a loop, you need to make sure that you have the indentation correct here. Indentations are four spaces here in Python. If you don't follow the indentation, then this is actually going to break your code, your interpreter. The syntax consists also of those indentations. So in this loop now, I can work with k and v, for example, print k and print value is the key, key for the value. So if I run this, you see we loop through the three elements. We print the key and then value is 1. V for the value, key for the key. That's how you loop through key value pairs in a dictionary. Alright, having seen this, you should be good to go. And I would like you to pause this video now and take the time to work on these four exercises. Alright, the next thing we will have a look at are conditions, basic if-else clauses in Python. Here's a first example. If we start an if condition, then we start with if. Here we compare whether a is smaller or less or equal to 2. And then our assignments, don't forget the indentation, these are very important. If we want to have another if clause, then we would follow that if with an elif, short for else if. And after that, we could actually come up with even more elifs. Elif a smaller 5, for example. Don't forget the correct indentation. Then we could indefinitely go on with those elifs, but the last one should be else. That would be then the clause which catches all conditions which are not caught in before. Alright, we can also have more conditions in one if condition. For example, here we just chain them with and. We could also do it with an or. And we can chain arbitrarily many conditions for a bigger, a smaller 2, for example. And another one is another special value is the none value, actually. You can see here, this none value has no specific data type. It stands for null. That means there is actually nothing, or it was not set before. And you would check for a none value by this syntax here, D is none or D is not none. You wouldn't use the double equation marks here or less equal signs. You would use is or is not for none. It's also pretty important. Okay, now going on to loops. We already had some loops in the exercise before, but now we are going to talk about them more in more detail, especially also for lists. So here we instantiate a list with the list operator and a range operator. Range 5 is outputting an iterator. Again, we have the iterator. This is not a list or tuple. It is something you can just iterate over. Range 5 returns an iterator returning integer numbers from 0 to 4. Again, 5 is exclusive here. And we convert this iterator back into a list. So L is going to be a list for integer numbers 0 to 4. Also, we will have L2 as an empty list. And now when we want to iterate over L, similar to the dictionary, we just type in 4, some variable name entry, which is arbitrary, in the list. Now we do not need to call items or something. This is dictionary specific. For lists or iterators, it's sufficient to just have the variable of the list here. So, and inside this for loop, we can play around with the entry in any way we want to. We just use that variable here accordingly. I could also say this one is now k, for example, and just print here k and use k for appending something to L2. For example, in this instance here, I'm appending always the squared version of every element in L and append it to L2. This is a Pythonic way for iterating through loops, because k is not the index of L, but the certain element of L. Just be cautious, you should not change inside a for loop the list you are actually iterating over. So it is best practice to instantiate the second list L2 here and append any element of L which was modified also in that new list. Because if we are iterating over L and at the same time we are modifying this list, this is going to break in indefinite ways. Alright. So this is the Pythonic way. You could also do it C style by going through the index of the list. For example, here we are now going to loop through an iterator. Again, range is returning an iterator, and the iterator the range is going from 0 to the length of the list L. So with len of something, we can get the length of the list. If here the list is 5 elements long, so this is going to be again an iterator with integers from 0 to 4. Index is going to have value 0 to 4 now. And with that squared bracket notation here, we can then index the list at some certain index here. This is going to work out perfectly fine as well. It is more useful to use this index way if you're going to index lists not exactly at the current index, but also at other indices as well. Then this is more straightforward. But if you always need only the certain index you're currently at in that for loop, then it would be more Pythonic to use this first version of the for loop. And another handy thing would be the enumerate function here. You can put any iterator, list tuple, or dictionary items iterator, for example, in here. And what you will get is a two-element tuple. First element of that tuple is going to be the enumerated index starting from 0, and the second element of that tuple entry here is going to be whatever is the actual output of looping through that object here, that list. So in this way we can always have both the index and the actual entry. Now going over to the next topic, there is a syntactically convenient thing in Python, which is called list comprehensions and dictionary comprehensions. This denotes a special way of instantiating lists and dictionaries in terms of loops. So for example, imagine we first instantiate a list the way we did before by converting an iterating from 0 to 49 into a list here by calling list at range. And here in the second line, in the next instantiation for L2, this is an actual list comprehension. How do we see that? It is encapsulated by squared brackets, and inside those squared brackets there is the for loop syntax. How does it actually work? So it is always, or most of the time, it consists of three stages. The first stage here is how we want to modify each element of something we're iterating over. The second stage is how we call each element in the list, tuple, object, whatsoever. In this case, entry. And the third stage pertains to what we are actually iterating over. So what happens here is that L2 is going to be a list where each entry in L2 is going to be the very same entry as in L, but squared. Entry double asterisk means to the power of, so entry to the power of 2 is the squared version of entry. We can extend this even further by adding not only a for loop, but also if conditions in that for loop. So what happens here? In this way, having an if condition after the for loop, what we do eventually is to filter out some elements. So when we were taking each element here in this line for instantiating L2, here we are not taking every element, but only those where the element of L, where the squared element of L is going to be greater than 100. So L2 consequently will be a smaller list than L after this operation. There's actually another way of entering if-else clauses. For example, we could say L3 is going to be entry squared. And now we could come up with the if else. For example, if entry squared is greater than 100, else entry squared, entry to the power of 3, for example. And now we conclude with the for loop for entry in L. This is also possible, and the effect is that we're not going to have a smaller list L3. L3 is going to be of the same size than L. We're not filtering out, but rather we are deciding on the specific way we want to have each element of L3 transformed, either to have the entry squared or the entry to the power of 3, depending on some condition. Okay, the same thing is also possible for dictionaries. We just use curly braces instead of squared brackets. And we, of course, have a colon here because we have to differentiate between keys and values. In this case, we're going to loop through the list again. You can see that here, the for loop. But each element's key is going to be the specific entry in that list, and each element's value is going to be the squared version of that entry. And again, a filter, you take only those elements where the squared entry is going to be greater than 100. Here you see the corresponding output. Python is an object-oriented programming language. That's why we have, of course, also functions and classes. The way how functions are defined is exemplified here. there's always a def for definition in front of the function name, in this case sub, and then a number of arguments we want to give into that function. Below the function, we usually put some comment for the function description, but this is only optional, and some logic. Aval minus bval, for example, could be another variable c, whatsoever. And this function should end with a return statement. We return some value, in this case not a single variable, but the return of some operation, in this case a value minus b value. We can define this function anywhere in a cell, on top, below, wherever we want to. This would be also the case for a script, not only in JPyter notebooks. And having defined this function means we can also use this function now below. In this case, for example, we have two variables a and b now, and we're showcasing in four print statements how to use that function. We could enter a and b in this order, we could switch the orders. There's just a coincidence that a and b are similar to the arguments in this function sub. So it doesn't mean that we have to specify which variable is going to be which one, which is showcased here, where we specifically say b value is going to be b, a value is going to be a. We can omit the specifications by just putting them in a certain order, and the Python interpreter is going to assume that we follow the order in which the arguments are defined here in the function. So for classes, we have the definition class in front of the class name, in this case dog. Below also some descriptive string, which describes what we want to do with that class. Each class should have an init function, which is encapsulated with two double scores. So this one is going to be called automatically if we instantiate a new class of dog. And an important thing is that each function inside the class dog, also starting with a def, should have the self argument as first argument in that function. This is mandatory, you cannot skip that, and pertains to the standard syntax of the Python language, so this is mandatory. But we can, next to that self argument, have arbitrarily many other arguments in each function, also in the init function, which we could just define next to that. Could also put name here, another variable, and so on and so forth. We can give them default values like this. If we say some variable equals something, then this is going to be the default value of that variable. That means, in this case, for the sit function, for example, if I call sit, it would be mandatory to give an argument for name, but it would not be mandatory to give a value for another variable here, because it has a default value. This is how we can force or enforce a function to get arguments or not. Now with this self argument, we are actually setting attributes for the class. So self name is an attribute of any instance of the class doc, which can also be accessed in other functions of that class. So since during initialization we gave the class doc already the argument name, which is converted to a class attribute, self name, we can also use that in the other function sit by referring to it with self.name. So if we instantiate now this example by assigning a new instance of doc, where we give it the name Lucky, and the variable is going to be small d dog. After defining that, we can call sit, and we will get this print statement, which is the content of the sit function. So having seen these basic concepts to functions and classes, You will get the next exercise. Now, two small exercises. Write a class cat with an init function that takes breed as argument and sets the same attribute. Remember the self argument. If the breed argument is neither Balinese nor Bengal, an error statement is to be printed. Give the cat a function pet. If the cat is Balinese, print mew. If the cat is Bengal, print pure. Then for the second exercise, create another class, Crazy Cat Lady, which initializes without arguments an attribute cats, which is a list of 10 Balinese and 5 Bengal cats. Create a class function throw, which removes one cat from her set of cats. So now there it's going to be important that we have for each instance of Crazy Cat Lady also a certain set of cats which can be appended or deleted partially. Create a class function talkToCats which returns a dictionary of her remaining cats with keys being random names and values being the corresponding cat. So with random names, I mean you can give them any name you want. It's not important for this exercise. Alright, please pause this video now and try to solve these two exercises. Now to conclude this Python overview exercise, I will give a very small brief outlook on numerical computing. And hopefully this gives you a hint why we actually need or why we should use NumPy instead of pure Python. So in this first cell, we use pure Python to do a matrix multiplication. We want to multiply the matrix A, which is two-dimensional. That means we have two rows and three columns. We do that by embedding two lists into a big list. And for B, this is also a two-dimensional matrix, but with three rows and two columns. That means we have three lists in one list. We want to have the result of this matrix multiplication in C, which is correspondingly to be a 2 times 2 matrix. Now, the C style to do this would be to iterate over each element of A and each element of B and place the corresponding multiplication, the corresponding product in C. And you can see this is done by three for loops here, using enumerate, using zip, which is actually returning just each element of A and B in these two values, A and B underscore. And another enumerate here, the third loop, where the actual logic is just to multiply A and B and place it at the corresponding index of C. I can tell you this is going to be very slow because for loops in Python are comparably slow compared to other programming languages like C or C++, where for loops are actually pretty fast, but that's also because they are compiled and Python as a script language is not compiled but interpreted at runtime. So since we still want to have very fast numerical computing, we should take into account other packages like NumPy, which has functions and packages pre-compiled in C and C++, such that we call the Python functions of NumPy that we get the same speed as in C or C++. So matrix multiplication would boil down now into calling matmul for matrix multiplication, A and B, and this is going to be considerably faster. Okay, this concludes the Python overview. If you have a look at our exercises, there's also a Python detailed. This is for your self-study and goes into more details of the Python syntax and language and should be comprehensible after this Python overview tutorial. We will go through the NumPy lesson now. And the rest is for your self-study, and just if you're ambitious and want to learn more about other packages, especially SciPy and Pandas is going to be optional, but I would like you to have a look for sure into the matplotlib exercise as well, and the Gertrude Gold NumPy tutorial exercise is also pretty useful. Okay, we're going to the NumPy notebook now as a last exercise for this tutorial. NumPy is going to be especially useful for us in this lecture because we're going to work a lot with numerical computation in the following tutorials, so please spend a lot of attention to this tutorial, to this package. Okay, after this tutorial you can also have a look at the documentation, the official website, and also of course intros to NumPy YouTube videos to get a firmer grip on how to use NumPy. You will, as I said, use it a lot, so that would be helpful. And to just give you a quick start, we will go through the basic operations of NumPy now. So first of all, of course, you have seen that before, import NumPy and then abbreviate NumPy as NP to just have less clutter. The way we instantiate an array would be by calling NumPy array and giving it then a tuple or list. In this case, a list 2, 3, 4. So this is going to be then a NumPy array of 3 elements. And what's actually the difference to a list here? Since a list can have mixed data types, it's going to be considerably slower to access each element of that list, and the interpreter has to check each element for its data type first before it can operate with it. This is not the case for NumPy arrays. Here, each element has to be the very same data type, similar to actually any other programming language like MATLAB or C, where you also have the same data type for each element in an array. So one might say we are losing some flexibility, but we are trading it off with a lot of speed. So data type, you can get the data type of an array by calling the attribute dtype of an array, which will return int32, which was automatically inferred from what we have given to it, 2, 3, 4. We could have specified that also with another dtype by giving it another argument, like here, dtype numpy float 64, for example. Let's import this first. Okay. So now it's going to be an array of dtype float, 64 float. You see the dtype is then correspondingly float 64. Here for B, this has been found automatically because we gave it floating point numbers, so the dtype is float 64 automatically. If we give it integers and floating numbers, then it will come up with the dtype which is the most appropriate. Since we can only have one dtype, it takes the most complex one, in this case a float dtype. You can check that again with C dtype, float 64. So we can automatically instantiate a matrix of zeros or ones, same as in MATLAB, by calling numpy zeros and then the shape of the matrix we want to have. A shape is just the number of columns, rows, or even more dimensions if we want to go beyond a two-dimensional tensor. In this case, if we give as a shape a two-element tuple, then we will get a two-dimensional tensor, which is a matrix. In this case, we want a matrix of zeros with 3 rows and 4 columns. So, correspondingly, we get this output here. Same goes for ones. If we call NumPy ones, we can get any tensor of any shape by just giving the shape, and also with a certain data type by giving an argument dtype with the corresponding dtype. In this case, this is a three-dimensional tensor where the first dimension has 2 elements, the second has 3, and the third one has 4 elements. So this can go arbitrarily beyond. It's just a matter of abstract thinking. So similar to the range for lists, where we would get an iterator for integer numbers, we can also just instantiate an array which was ranged over some start and end value. Again, we take 0 and 5, and also a step size 0.5. So calling this, we will get a one-dimensional array or vector with elements which are equidistant to each other by step size 0.5, as you can see below. We can have a different start value, for example 10, and the end value is going to be 20, exclusive 20 again. So we will start at 10 and end at 19, since we haven't given any step size. The step size by default is 1. And the start value by default is 0, so just giving one integer value will have the 4 as an exclusive end value, and start at 0 to get this 4-element vector. You may know from MATLAB also the linspace function, which is also present at NumPy, so NumPy linspace of 0, 2, and 9 will return an array with, again, equidistant elements, where the distance between those elements is calculated by having 9 equidistant elements in the range from 0 to 2, which is the below output. Now, going further, you can print an array, print A, which looks like a list, but in this case it's an array. It's just the string representation of an array. That's why it doesn't say array as it was before here. We can subtract arrays from each other, as you know it from MATLAB probably. We can also take the squared of each element. Now, this is maybe a distinctive feature between Python and MATLAB, or a key difference. By default, each operation on arrays or matrices is going to be element-wise. For MATLAB, it would require you to put a dot in front of the operation to make it element-wise, but here it is the default. So squaring B is not going to return the dot product of B and B, but actually the element-wise squaring of B. We can call sinus with NumPy sinus, so 2 times NumPy sine of B. We can have Boolean types by just putting, for example, B lesser than 4 into the variable F, and F is going to be an array of true and false values. Keep in mind that true and false always have to start with a capital T or capital F. That's important. You can get the minimum of an array with array.min, and then parentheses, the maximum correspondingly with max, the sum of all arrays with sum, and the mean value with mean correspondingly. There's even more among those that I have shown here. You can look them up in the internet. So how do we index arrays? So here's going to be a certain two-dimensional array. We can index by comma-separated indices, like here, 2 and 2 will return number 2, starting from 0, of course. So that means 0, 1, 2, and then 0, 1, 2 will return the 2.0. That's what we get here. If we want to index whole rows, we can do that by first saying which row we want, and then a colon for saying we want all elements in that row. Conversely, if we want a column, we just say we want all elements in the row, but at a certain column. So this is going to be a three-dimensional vector then. And we can also iterate over a two-dimensional array by saying for row in A, A is the array here, and then the element row is going to be the whole row. If we want to iterate over the columns or through a certain element in each row, then we would say give me a certain row, and then for entry in this row we get the scalar value in there. And yeah, if you would want to iterate over the columns, then you would write something like for column in a dot capital T for the transpose, and then print col, then you get each value in there. Let me instantiate that A first, so now I get each column. Okay, there is one very important attribute in each array or NumPy array, which is the shape. Calling shape, you would get the dimensions of that array. So three rows and four columns in this case. Going forward, we also often use the reshape argument for NumPy matrices if you want to change the shape, or if we want, for example, to make some certain transposes or to have to flatten something, or if you want to make a one-dimensional array to a two-dimensional one where we have only one row or one column, for example. This is also very often the case. Then we use the reshape argument, like here. First, this vector was a one-dimensional one. You can see that by calling vector shape. So it was 12. So you see, this is a one-dimensional tuple. Shape is always giving tuples, and since we have a one-dimensional vector, it will also give a one-element tuple. So 12 elements in this vector. If we call reshape 3, 4. Then those 12 elements will be rearranged into a 3 times 4 matrix. If you compare those two arrays, then you will see the logic behind reshaping. Of course, if I would call now, if I would want to rearrange them in some shape which is not possible, like now, then I will get an error correspondingly, because that shape cannot be completely filled. I could also make a 4 times 3. It is just the flattened array enumerated across each row. Getting the vector norm is going by NumPy linalg for linear algebra, and then the norm of that vector we will get as a scalar here. The norm of a matrix can be done axis wise. If we just give it another argument, axis, so then we would get for each column the norm. And if you want to solve a linear equation system, m times x equals n, if we want to find x, then we can do that with linalg.solve. Okay, random sampling, also important for our courses. There is a subpackage random in NumPy where we can sample from a normal distribution. Rand n stands for the normal distribution. If you just call it without any arguments, you will get a number with a mean of 0 and standard unit deviation. If we say 10, we will get 10 sample values from that random normal deviation. If we give it two values, then it will be a matrix, so 3 times 5 values will be sampled, and with that certain shape we would get them back. If you just want integers, random integers, you can do that with randint. If you want a value which is going from one certain value to a maximum value, you can specify that with high. So calling that repeatedly, we will get random integer values here. And we can, of course, also have that in a certain shape. So again, if you want 15 different ones, then we can give it a shape with size. Size equals the shape 5 times 3, so we will get a 5 times 3 matrix. That means 15 different random integers from 5 to 100. So we can also save any NumPy arrays on disk. Here's a small toy example how to do that. Here it is done as a text file, but for sure there are better ways to save numbers on disk. Here this is just for your example as an example, just to show how we can access any data here with the package OS, which we have imported in the beginning. We can make a directory with mkdir data. Here we can first check whether this data folder is existing. If not, then we would make it. And here we just save some random Gaussian sampled numbers, 15 of those numbers. We would save them into that variable txt and then save them into a file called test.txt in that data folder. If you want to load that from disk to memory again, we can do that with load text, but we have to make sure that the delimiters are also the same. And if you just want to filter them, then we could also do that with skip rows, for example, or use codes. Okay, this is a very brief overview of how to use NumPy. We will use a lot of NumPy in the following tutorials, so I would strongly recommend to have a look at this notebook here, Gertin Gold NumPy tutorial exercises, which I would like you to do as a self-study. Have a close look at this, and if you have read all of those notebooks here, especially the NumPy and Matplotlib ones, then you should be good to go for the upcoming tutorials. Anyway, if you are a beginner in Python, I would recommend strongly that you get yourself familiar with the fundamentals of Python. Not only those notebooks here, but maybe also other notebooks or other tutorials you can find in the internet or that we have posted in the first cell of some notebooks here. Go through them, get the Python knowledge, and then you should be really good to go for the upcoming tutorials. We also have in the README here a few instances or websites where you can get a free notebook server if you find your own machine not performant enough to run the notebooks here, which should actually not be the case. But anyway, there is the possibility to have online live notebook kernels not running on your own machine, but in the cloud. This concludes the first tutorial of the reinforcement learning lecture. I hope you liked it. If you have any questions, then please don't hesitate to post them in our Pandas forum. Thank you.